Church. Good morning. Good to see you guys. You guys good today? That's good. I like that. Energetic. I like it. All right. So before we get this worship started, would you guys just join me in prayer? God, we thank you so much for today. We pray that you do things like never before. We pray that you move in this place like we've never experienced. God, we come against just any fear, any type of thing that will try to distract from the faith that you're building right now, from the things that you're moving in right now, and the things that you're going to say today. We just come against all that in the name of Jesus. We pray that you would just help us to just focus on you and your love and your goodness today. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Something right now that he is moving. Come on, how many of you believe that? He is up to something.
He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something right now. He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something right now. He is healing someone. He is saving someone. God is doing something right now. He is healing someone. He is saving someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something.
Come on, sing it again.
He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something.
All of my hope,
all of my hope is in the name, the name. turn it around. God, turn it around. And God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something right now. He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something right now.
Sing it again.
He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something right now. He is up to something. He is up to something. He is up to something.
Come on, all of my hope.
All of my hope is in the name of Jesus. And breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus.
Come on, sing that again. I hear God saying right now,
all of my hope is in the name of Jesus. And breakthrough will come, it'll come in the name of Jesus. So God, turn it around. 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 God, turn it around.
Yeah. Come on, I hear God saying that right now. That whatever is going on in your life, whatever you're seeing around you, that breakthrough will come, but it will come in the name of Jesus. So if there's anything else that you're looking to for hope, if there's anything else that you're looking to that will bring that breakthrough, whatever it is, forget about it. He says, in the name of Jesus. So I hear him even saying right now, whatever that circumstance is, you know what it is. Whatever it is that's on your mind right now, say it and say, in the name of Jesus, there is breakthrough. Come on, right now, take a moment. Just if you have to whisper, if you have to shout it out, whatever it is, say the thing and say, in the name of Jesus, breakthrough. Come on, take a moment, just say it. Whatever it is, if it's multiple things, say it and say, in the name of Jesus, breakthrough. Come on, say it right now, in the name of Jesus, breakthrough. Come on, in the name of Jesus, breakthrough. Woo!
It's all of my hope. Is in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus. Well, all of my hope is in the name of Jesus. And breakthrough will come, come in the name of Jesus. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Oh, yeah. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Yeah. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. Oh, and God, turn it around. 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 And God, turn it around.
Come on, I hear faith coming through.
God, turn it around. Yeah, yeah. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
Come on, let your faith be using words right now. Put it in action.
God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around. And God, turn it around. 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 God, turn it around.
Come on, speak it out in faith.
God, turn it around. God, Silence all my fear. I won't be afraid. You won't let go. Be still my heart and know that I won't be afraid. Yeah. Oh, no, I won't know.
Come on.
Be still. Your peace and kindness will follow me. It will follow me. And surely love and mercy, Your peace and kindness will follow me.
Come on, here, guys, sing. Just because it's getting quiet in here, don't let your voice get quiet. Come on. Your love surrounds me.
Your love surrounds me. Your love surrounds me.
Come on.
Your love surrounds me.
Today is a day to speak out in faith, so don't hold back. Just speak it out. Woo!
Surrounds me, Your love surrounds me.
Sing it out, yes.
Your love surrounds me, Your love surrounds me.
Declare it as faith because you know it is true.
Peace and kindness
will
follow me. It will follow me. Surely love and mercy, Your peace and kindness, it will follow me. It will follow me. Surely love and mercy, Your peace and kindness will follow me, will follow me.
Will follow me.
And I won't be afraid. You are here. You silence all my fear. I won't be afraid. You don't let go. Be still my heart and know. I won't be afraid. Be afraid.
on, give Jesus the praise today.
God says that perfect love casts out fear. And many times we allow fear to come in when the word of God is very specific to you, that he has not given us a spirit of fear. Hello? He has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and a sound mind. I love that. That he says that he has given us sound mind. You know, when it comes to this moment of the worship, when we bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord, many times we allow fear to come in. We are worshiping God and all of a sudden this is a different moment. And it should not be. It should just be an extension of our worship. When fear has no place. And I love when he says he has given us a sound mind. That's why he's called us to understand his word and what it says about anything that we do for him. And the word of God is very specific when it talks about giving, that we don't give with fear. We give with joy. You know, joy cannot be in a heart that is filled with fear. And the word of God actually says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. So that's why we struggle sometimes in our finances, because we don't have a sound mind when it comes to giving. And God has called us to, when it comes to that part in our service, to give him what he has bestowed unto us so freely. How many can truly say that God has been good to you? Even in the midst of famine, even in the midst of 2020, amen, God has been faithful. We're standing here today because our God is a faithful God. He's a good God. And he actually says, you know, the psalmist understood that when he says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He starts the psalm like that, but he ends it saying, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So he understood that when it comes to the Lord, he's always good. He's always faithful. He's always kind. That's the God we serve. And that's why when we have a true understanding, a sound mind, when it comes to giving, we have no fear. Amen? And we can give freely because our God is a faithful God. And he has promised a good harvest for our sins. Amen? So as you give today as an extension of your worship, as you worship him with your tithes and your offerings, just remember, give it with a sound mind. My God is he is faithful, and he gives me the strength and the understanding to be able to give. And that's why we give. Amen. So just worship him as I love to sing God Turn It Around, the first song. How many are believing for that? We are just in the beginning of 2021, and I believe that this is going to be the year that God is going to turn some things around. He's already working. He's already doing it. Amen. I love when he says he's up to something. Do you believe that? Can you turn to somebody and just say, God is up to something. God is up to something. He's doing something right now.
He is up to something. He is up to something. God is doing something right now.
There's many ways you can give. You can bring it here, and you can give it the other way there. Amen.
God is doing something right now. He is healing someone. He is saving someone. God is doing something right now. He is healing someone. He is saving someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something right now. He is moving mountains, making a way for someone. God is doing something right now.
We are so thankful that for your faithfulness, that you've been faithful through it all. No matter what the circumstances we face, Lord, you remain good. You remain perfect. You remain in control. So we bless you with everything that we are. We exalt you above all things, above every circumstance that can come against us, because you are in control. And we thank you in Jesus' name. And everyone says amen. Come on, give him praise. Thank you, Lord. Woo. Amen. Would you just turn around and say hello? How you doing? I know we cannot go around kissing everybody, but at least we say hello from afar. Amen. Amen. Woo, what a powerful worship. I didn't want to stop. Amen. Are you glad you came to the house of God this morning? Amen. I just have one announcement. I don't know if you noticed when you came in, that we finally had our verse on top of the map. You notice that? When you come in the lobby, that's the vision for this church. And we want everyone to come in to know what God has called us for. Amen. And he called us for the nations. So I believe Caleb is probably going to repeat the verse with you. If you don't know, just stand in the lobby for a while and memorize. It's going to be good for you. Amen. But we want to increase that decoration. We want to actually put the flags of the nations we already represented in this place. You know, it's incredible that we are a very small congregation, but we already have seven nations in this place. So God has truly called us for nations. Amen. As I was noticing, we have USA. Nobody with USA? We have Brazil. We have Argentina. We have Cuba. We have Peru, but I don't believe she's here right now. We have China. Actually, Taiwan. How do you say that name? Taiwan. Do you believe that we have all these nations represented? And Portugal also. Oh, my God, I forgot about that one. And we have all these nations represented. Republic Dominican. I forgot you. I forgot you. And Dennis. Your nation, Nicaragua. So you see, that's a lot of nations in one small place. But God has called us. He said, ask of me and I will give you nations as an inheritance. And we believe in for that. We agreeing for that. But we want to put the flags there. And what I want to do is this. You can donate one flag. It's $7. Because I'm doing this so you don't have to bring you a big flag and the other brings a smaller one. So it's better to order in the same place. So if you want to donate one flag today, look for me right after the service. Put in an envelope and put in the name of the flag you want to donate. And if somebody already donated for that one, then we ask you to choose another one. Amen? And we're going to buy. So it's going to be beautiful. The lobby, when people come in, they're going to see what we see in the spirit. That God is giving us the nations. And we want everyone, each one of you, to dream about it, to run with it, and to believe for it. How many can say amen? Amen. Amen. So don't forget to look for me after the service. And we probably by next week, if we can, we will have at least some of them outside. Amen? Caleb?
Good morning, guys. What's up? Oh, my God. I love it. What a difference from a month ago. You guys are very lively now. I love it. All right. Come on, give a shout of praise right now. Just give him a shout of praise. You feel that faith in the air? You feel it? It's oof. All right, so you guys already know the drill. I'm going to count to three, and we're going to shout out Jesus. And then right after, I'm going to count to three, and we're going to say thank you. All right, you ready? One, two, three. Jesus! One, two, three. Thank you. Jesus, we just want to say thank you that you are good, that you love us. We thank you that you're for us. And I pray that we can start to believe that more and more now, that you are for us, you are not against us, that you are in control, you are good, and you have already paved the way for us. And we just need to trust. We just thank you for that, God. And guys, I'm already going to just pray right now for the churches around the world. So let's go into that. God, we just pray right now for all the churches around the globe. Right now that you just bring comfort, you bring relief, and you bring a boldness and a courage to use the authority that God has given the church. I pray that right now it is the time for the church to rise, and I pray the church rises up. I pray for all the churches that are wavering and struggling, that you bring the message to them. Stand up and speak the word. So I pray right now a boldness and a rising and a great awakening of the body of Christ in the whole wide world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, guys. Remember I kept saying, yeah, we don't have the verse on the wall yet, so we have to say here. Did you guys see the verse on the wall? That's amen. Come on. I like that Jeremy clap. Can we clap for that? That was a great breakthrough. That verse with the world map is the calling for more than conquerors. So what is the verse again? Where is it found? Oh, wait, you're getting ahead of me. Shoot, they're ready. Now, what does the verse say? Man, that's so good. I remember the first time nobody said it. That is so good. So let's say one more time. Psalms 2a. Ask of me, and I will give you the nations as your inheritance. That is the call of this church. So right now, we're going to pray and ask. Amen? God, right now, we ask, bring the nations. Whatever way it is that we can be used, use us and open the doors. Bring the right people and just use One of the Conquerors that the world will know that we can be used to help them. Use us to that level that the world will know More Than Conquerors because we're being used so mightily to help nations so that more and more nations can come and receive help. So use us, and whatever door needs to be opened, God, in the name of Jesus, it is. In the name of Jesus, we say, amen. All right, guys, that's everything I got for you today. Will you guys please welcome Pastor Aldo?
Good morning, people of faith. How's your faith this morning? Well, half the church is strong. How about the other half? What's up with you guys? Let's try again. How's your faith this morning? Glory to God. That's better. Amen. Speaking of faith, how many of you brought your journals for the year? Only two? Me and her, three. Remember last week, four? Remember? I said we're going to write down what we are believing God for the year 2021. And as I mentioned last week, I've seen every year when we do this, it's a release of our faith, which God honors. He loves when we step out in faith. And as we do this, we see how He begins to move. And by the end of the year, you're going to see everything that you wrote here come to pass. Except if you ask for a divorce, that's not going to be answered, okay? You have a testimony already. Okay, you'll tell it later, okay? Well, that's good. God's already doing things. All right, amen. There's no limit to what we can ask God, amen? So I want to use Mark chapter 11, verse 23 and 24. We're going to put it up there for you to see. It's a very well-known verse where it says, this is Jesus speaking, says, truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, mountain could be representative of your difficulties, things that are in your way, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen, it will be done for them. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. It will be yours. Not someday. No, it will be. When is it yours? When you ask. Not when you receive, when you ask. When you ask and believe is when you receive. And then after that, you just thank him for it because it's on his way. I think I need to say that again. Let's try it again. Jesus said, first of all, don't doubt in your heart. Okay? That's what he says. Don't doubt in your heart, but believe that what you say is going to happen. So right now, believe that what we're going to say, believe that what we wrote here, that we can read and say it, is going to happen. Can you do that? This is the qualifier. So believe that what you wrote here and that you can speak it by reading it is going to happen. Okay? And Jesus said, if you can do this, it will be done for you. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, not will receive it, but have received it. Present tense. Then he finishes by saying, it will be yours. So simple. So, when are you going to receive this? Now. Now. As we ask for it. Not when we see it, but when we pray and ask for it. We receive it. That's biblical faith. So are you ready to receive it? All right, if you don't have your journal with you, that's okay. Maybe it's at your house. Maybe in your heart you already know what you want God to do for you. But nevertheless, when you get home today, get a piece of paper, get a booklet or a journal. Write down what you desire in your heart to see God to do in your life in 2021. Will you do that? It's for your own good. Amen. So if you have your journals, raise it up in the air. If you don't, just raise your hand. Your journal's in your heart right now. There's things that you would like for God to do in 2021. Let's do it according to Mark 11, 23 and 24. Amen, church? Say with me, Lord Jesus, we present this journal and these requests that are in our hearts for 2021. According to Mark 11, 23 and 24, which is your word that never returns empty, we ask of you for all of these requests to come to pass in 2021. Lord, we believe and we receive it because we're asking for it right now. We take it, Lord. It's ours. And we believe that in 2021, the year will not end until we see all this come to pass. We ask you in faith, and we receive it now in the Jesus' name. Amen, church. Woo! Say, I receive it. It's mine. Tell your neighbor, we received it. It's ours. It's ours. Oh, glory to God. Amen. Amen. Now, see, this prayer sealed it. It sealed it. Even if you are a little skeptical about this, he's not. The angels around you are not. They're taking very seriously what you've just said because you spoke God's word. So, he takes it seriously. So raise your hand like this and say this. Hosts of heaven, we release you to go and fulfill what has been believed today in the word of God. Go, go, and go, and bring it to pass in Jesus' name. Amen. Woo, glory to God. You know what you just did? You just released the angels. Hallelujah, that are here to minister to the believers in Christ. Amen. Why are you excited today? Amen. We're entering to 2021 with faith and excitement and great expectation, church. Great expectation. God is up to something good. Amen. How many would say God is up to something good? Yes, he is. So glad you're here today. So glad. We got old families here. I was thinking today, I got to stop mentioning people's names. You know why? Because we're videotaping this. Seriously. just this week, I'm like, man, I got to stop saying people's names because we are videotaping this for the whole world to see. So maybe people don't want to be known. So hello, everybody. Without mentioning your names. Good to see you here this morning. We love you. Are you ready for the word? The message is called, It's Not Time. And by the way, next week's message is called, Get in the Boxing Arena. Get in the boxing arena. It's time to fight. Get in the boxing arena. So if you don't know what boxing is, if you don't know how to fight, next week you're going to learn how to fight in the spirit. Fighting, amen. But today it's called It's Not Time. It's not time. As you consider what is happening in the world today, everything that you've been hearing so far, 2020, okay, last year, what would you say are your expectations for the future? Be honest. Okay, wonderful. One believes it's going to be wonderful. Amen to that, brother. New beginnings. Okay. That's today. In the glory, the excitement. But throughout the year 2020, if you go back a few months when we were first facing what we faced, what do you think were the expectations, your expectations? What do you think were blessings? What do you think were the expectations of the world? Disaster. Fake news. That's the word. That's all I can remember for 2021. Fake news. Yes. When you look at the world, all you see is doom and gloom. But you know, I've noticed, not in this church, but I've noticed that this fear crept into the churches. And as I was watching Christian TV, well, I should say Christian channels on YouTube, I tuned into this minister. If I were to say his name, everybody would know him. He's very well known throughout the world. He got up on TV and looked at the camera and said, "Brothers and sisters, Jesus is coming." Hold on a minute. We know he is coming. But there's a difference when I say, "Brothers, Jesus is coming soon," versus, "Jesus is coming soon, get me out of here now." There's a difference. The first one, Jesus is coming soon because he is coming soon, and I hope he comes quickly, but I want him to come once I or the church has accomplished what it was sent here to do. And not come back to escape me from the problems that I'm facing today and that we're facing. So there's a difference. This minister was speaking about the latter one. And I'm like, no, no, don't say that to the church because that is not from God. I was doing some research about how many times people have predicted the end of the world. Because there's been a lot of people saying that. This is the end of the world. It's over. And I'm like, no, no. So I said, let me do some research. Guess what I discovered? That since the turn of the millennium, we have had 167 predictions that the world was going to end. Actually, one is set for 2021. 167 times. And we're still here. Look at your neighbor and say, "And we're still here." You know what that tells us? Don't set dates. Jesus never told us the date. He told us the season, but he never told us which day. Why? Because if he told us, we would do nothing. We would live only for that day. when Jesus is saying, live for today. And don't worry about the day. The day will come, but if you focus only on the day, you'll become ineffective today. Are you still with me? So, first thing that you need to know, it's not time for the end of the world. I can hear a laugh. I know where that's coming from. Because a lot of people in the churches today are believing or hearing this. It's the end of the world. And because they're hearing this, maybe not here, but maybe outside, people are discouraged and they have allowed fear to paralyze them. So listen to me. It's not the time for the end of the world. In Matthew chapter 24, let's turn our Bibles. Matthew chapter 24. Okay. If you brought your electronic Bibles, then you know what you have to do. Those of you that brought a physical Bible like I did, I have to actually turn the pages. So be patient with me. Here we go. Matthew chapter 24. Jesus talks about the end of times. And in verse 1, it says, Jesus left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to him to call his attention to its buildings. Do you see all these things? He asked. I'll tell you the truth. Not one stone here will be left on another. Everyone will be thrown down. Wow, how would you like somebody to tell that about your city? He was referring to Jerusalem, which was destroyed in AD 70. As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will this happen, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name claiming I am Christ and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Would you like to know where we are right now in God's timeline? Right here. The end is still to come. Maybe 100 years from now, maybe 200 years, maybe 500 years in the future. Now he begins to share more signs of what it's going to look like in the end of the end times. But if you read it, which I don't have time to go over with you right now, it does not describe what is happening today. It describes future events. So what he is saying to us today is two things. First of all, he says, don't be alarmed. That's what he says right here at the end of verse 6. But see to it that you are not alarmed. This word alarmed in the Greek verb tense, this is something that you need to know, it's important, is in the present imperative with a negative, which means it's very important. So if we would read this alarmed in the Greek verb tense, we would say like this in English. Stop being frightened. And if you're not frightened yet, it says this, don't even let this fright begin. So when the Bible says here, Jesus saying, don't be alarmed, in the original Greek verb, he was saying, listen to me, stop being afraid. And if you're not afraid yet, don't even entertain fear in your life. Because the end is still ahead. It's still to come. It's not the time yet. If you misunderstand this and think for one moment that the end is near, very near, then it's going to paralyze you. It's going to lead you to hopelessness and fear, where you're no longer going to plan for your future. You're no longer going to be occupied and busy with what God has given for you to do today. It's like this. What if I bought a ticket to go to Brazil? I'm going to fly to Brazil. But the day that I bought the ticket for is for next Sunday. But because I'm so fearful, I'm afraid that I might hit traffic and miss my flight. I'm afraid that I might get a flat tire, get into an accident and miss my flight. So I choose to go to the Sunday's flight tomorrow. I go to the airport, and then I walk in, I sit down, and then I just stay there for the next 6 days. Because I'm afraid. I want to make sure that when the flight is there and my time comes, I'm the first one in line, first one to board the airplane. That way I'm sure that I'm not going to miss my flight. You might not miss your flight, but you're going to spend 6 days bored doing nothing. And then it's canceled. Then it's canceled. That's all you need, right? Yeah, go figure, right? So what just happened here? You have just wasted 6 days where you could have been productive, doing things, working, taking care of business. When the time for the flight was still 6 days away. The flight to heaven, church, is way up ahead. Stop trying to go to the airport for that flight. It's not taking off. Not yet. But when it does take off, I'm pretty sure the captain will call us and let us know. But he's not calling yet. Actually, his orders is not to board the plane. His orders is to stay home and be busy where you are. It's busy. It's time for you to be busy with the opportunities that he's giving you today and the gifts that he put into your life. Remember last week's message? This is kind of like a part two. It's time for you to be busy with the opportunities and the gifts that he gave you. Let's go to Luke chapter 19, verse 11. Luke chapter 19, verse 11. This is a parable here that he was explaining to his disciples. And we're going to begin in verse 11, where it says, while they were listening to this, he went on to tell them a parable because he was near Jerusalem and the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. You know why he said this? Because at that time, they were all believing that Jesus, who was on his way to Jerusalem, was going to declare himself king. And once he did that, bang, the kingdom would be established, the millennium will come, everybody would be happy. So because they were thinking about this, they were thinking, yeah, Jesus is about to be declared king. Kingdom is going to be established. Everything's going to be great. He said, no, let me give you a little parable of what's really going to happen. Okay, so in verse 12, he says, a man of noble birth went to a distant country to have himself appointed king and then to return. So he called 10 of his servants and gave them 10 minas. Put this money to work, he said, until I come back. Put this money to work until I come back. Who is this noble man in the parable? Jesus. Who are the servants? You. Servants are the ones that he left in charge. What are the minas? The minas, literally in the parable, represents money. Actually, it represents 3 months of wages. Okay, and it represents gold or silver money. But for us here today, What does this represent? It represents things that are equally precious to God that he has given to us, which are different gifts, abilities, opportunities, tools, resources, finances, knowledge. Whatever God has put in you, created you to be, created for you to do. And I'm not just talking in the church. Because some are called to be ministers like me, my wife. But not everybody's called to. Actually, very, very few are called for that. And you ought to say thank God for that. The vast majority are called to go and work with the abilities and the gifts that God has put in you. And these are things that you already desire and already working with. Some of you are desiring, but you've never even considered it or thought it would be too hard for you. God wants to use his body in ways that you haven't even dreamed of yet. We think that the only spiritual gift and calling of God is what we do here at the church. You couldn't be more wrong. You can be just as spiritual working on a computer inventing software. You can be just as spiritual baking cakes and cookies and sweets that I love, by the way, at a bakery. You can be just as spiritual leading a corporation as a CEO. You can be just as spiritual becoming the leader of a cleaning business. You can be just as spiritual designing clothes, designing shoes, and having a brand name that is famous around the world. Those are called minas. There's another word for that. It's also called talents. And some of you you hate your job so much, and you wonder why. It's because you are never called to do that. Your true gift is not that. It's something else that you've never had the courage to go after and invest in. And God is waking the church up to put everybody where they need to be so that they would flourish where they are, be based on the gifts that he had put in them. There's this woman from our church. She's not here any longer. She got married and went to follow her husband where they are now. But while she was here, she went through a severe trial and she was facing a divorce. We helped her along. We counseled. We prayed. And she made it through it, but she lost everything. But she has leadership gifts and abilities that we saw in her. But she was so beat up because of what she went through that she couldn't see herself doing really anything. So we prayed and we believed. Later we found out that she started a business, a cleaning business. And the cleaning business began to grow, began to increase, and she began to employ. Now she employs a lot of people after almost 2 years. And she's so happy. She goes to work singing, praising God. Why? Because she is exactly where she needs to be. She's exercising her leadership skills. And she's blessing other women. She blesses our church with cleaning. And she's a happy person, and she's going to be happy for the rest of her life if she maintains this. Why? Because she's working with the gift that God has put in her. And she got married again. Who wouldn't want to marry a woman like that? Too bad for the guy who left her. He's missing out on all the best times of her life. Now she's going to share with somebody else. Amen. All right. So, what was Jesus' instruction? He said, carry on with business. Isn't that what he said? He said, put this money to work. Carry on with business. Put this money to work until I return. So God's word for us here today is, put your gift to work for you. And keep at it until he comes back. And he says, if you do this, there will be rewards. Actually, he continues in verse 14. He says, but his subjects hated him and sent a delegation after him to say, we don't want this man to be our king. That's when the Jews rejected him, of course. But he was made king, however, and returned home. Then he sent for the servants to whom he had given the money in order to find out what they had gained with it. Did you know that one day you're going to have to give account to the gifts that he gave you? You're going to stand before him. And he's going to ask you, what have you done with the gifts that I put in your life? You were called to be a painter. What were you doing fixing cars? Or you were called to fix cars. Why were you painting 24/7? We're going to have to give account. Everybody can say amen. This is serious. Fear-paralyzed church. No, I rebuke that in Jesus' name. Let's continue. The first one came and said, sir, your mina has earned 10 more. Now, how many minas did he give to all three? 10. So Jesus is an equal opportunity employer. Well done, my good servant, his master replied, because you have been trustworthy in a very small matter. Take charge of 10 cities. Wow. Talk about rewards. The second came to him, sir, your mina has earned 5 more. His master answered, you take charge of 5 cities. Then another servant came and said, sir, here is your mina. I have kept it. Watch this. I have kept it laid away in a piece of cloth. I was afraid of you because you are a hard man. You take out what you did not put in and reap what you did not sow. Now, is that true? No. He just gave him 10 minas. How could it be a hard man who tries to take what he doesn't put in? He just put in 10 minas. This was his perspective of him, not the reality of who that man was. It's his view of God. Then his master replied, I will judge you by your own words. In other words, this is how you see me, then I'm going to judge you by what you say. You wicked servant, you knew, did you, that I'm a hard man, taking out what I did not put in and reaping what I did not sow. Why then didn't you put my money on deposit so that when I come back, I would have collected it with interest? Then he said to those standing by, take this mina away from him and give it to the one who has 10 minas. Wow, so he took the mina from that third guy and gave it to the one and number two guy. Sir, they said, he already has 10. He replied, I tell you that everyone who has more will be given. But as for the one who has nothing, even what he has will be taken away. Notice that this man, this third guy, what did he do? He took the mina and he wrapped it in a cloth. That's a way of saying he hid his talents. He never allowed the talents that were given to him to work with him, or him work with the talents. He answers it. He says, because I was afraid of you. So fear will paralyze you. Fear will paralyze you from using the ability and the gift that he has given to you. Oh, I can't afford this. I can't afford this education. I really want to go and study this skill, but I just don't have the money. What is that? That is fear. You're saying that your father who owns the cattle in 1,000 hills, the gold and silver is mine, he says. You're saying that he can't provide you for an education? Fear is paralyzing you. You're taking that gift and you're folding it and putting it to a napkin. Oh, I want to be a nurse one day. I dream of helping people, but it's just too expensive, or I'm not smart enough. What are you talking about? If you put the gift and the desire in your heart, don't you think that you have the ability, the intelligence as well, to go after and fulfill that calling in your life? It's your fear that's paralyzing you. And you're mistaking him for a hard man when he's generous. And he gave you that gift, it's because he wants to make it come to pass in your life. But fear, like this third man, fear is paralyzing you. Your potential is being robbed by fear. And it's fear of the past. It's fear of others, what others are going to say. It's fear of loss, fear of failure. So don't let fear stop you. If there's something that is in your heart, a desire that God put in there, stop, keep bringing excuses for, oh, I'm an immigrant. I'll never be able to. Shut up. But, I mean, really, you need to be quiet, because the Bible says the power of life and death is in your tongue. You keep saying that, you're going to convince yourself the opposite of what God wants to do. You need to speak in line, in harmony with what God says in his word. God's got big plans for you. He has prepared big things for you and things that your heart longs to do. What is God saying? Do it! Make plans for it! Prepare yourself for it. Find out what needs to be done, how much it's going to cost, and believe God. As you take that step, you're going to see that God will start to move the mountains out of the way. And he'll bring people who will finance you. He'll bring people who will help you become legal in this country, even if you have to marry somebody. He'll find a way. All he wants you to do is to unfold that mina. Get it out of the cloth. Get it out of the napkin. You know why he called him a wicked servant? That bothered me. Because he was the servant. And yet Jesus called him wicked. I'm like, this is. So I said, no, I'm going to study this. Before I preach on Sunday, I got to find out why Jesus called his servant wicked. So I did some searching, and I came up with the answer. So aren't you glad? This word, wicked, is a Greek word called poneros. And it can be used in many ways as wicked or even as evil. It can be used for Satan, but it can also be used for a person who does not do the will of God. It all depends on the context of what is being communicated. So this word ponetos here, in the context of this story, means this. It means evil in a sense that it is in direct opposition of what is good for him. So when Jesus calls him wicked, he was saying, what you have done is in complete opposition of what I desire for you. I hope I'm not losing you with this. That's what he was saying. Have you noticed in the story that the first guy got back how many minas? 10. The second one got? The third one got? You know what that says? The only one who loses is the one who does nothing. The only person who loses is the person who does nothing with their calling and their ability. Because with God, once you take the step of faith and trust him, no matter how hard it is, he will back you up and he will make the impossible possible. And you never can lose, never, when you trust him and you step out. And keep in mind, equal opportunity was given to all three. 10 for the first, 10 for the second, 10 for the third. But only two invested that mina. The third one was too afraid, held it back, and in the end, he gained nothing. So it's time to unwrap your piece of cloth. Tap your neighbor and say, it's time to unwrap your piece of cloth. Throw out the excuses. Find out what you are called to be. Do some soul searching. Find out the desires of your heart, what you've dreamed about. You know, if your little boy, if your child, all he does is beat on the countertop all day long and beat on pans, that boy is called to be a drummer. He has a gift to play drums. If your little daughter, all she does is fix people's cuts and bruises with bandages and likes to help people and see if they have a fever and give them medicine, if that's what your little girl does, she's called to be a doctor or a nurse. Hello? If your little boy, all he does is want to preach and teach and be like the pastor, guess what he's called to do? Well, two amens on that one. I guess my profession's not too popular. So you need to stop feeling sorry for yourself. Stop giving yourself so many excuses of why it can't happen. And you need to start believing God that the meanness was given to you, and all you have to do is believe it and start making plans for it to work in your life. Some of you are called to be lawyers. Some of you are called to be the next mayor of our city. Some of you are called to design my next shoes that I'm going to wear. Some of you are called to design the next car that we're going to drive. Some of you are called to invent the next cure for illnesses, for diseases, for diabetes, for cancer. Some of you are called to bake and make the best dinner in the area and have the most prosperous restaurant in the community. What are you doing with your talents? See, that's what it means to have rule and to have dominion. As the church begins to go and use their talents and their meanness, their gifts in the community, you know what also happens? They take the gospel with them. They take their faith with them. They're baking their cakes, but their faith is there. They're talking to their employees about Jesus. They're talking to their customers about the Christ who died for their sins while they're eating your precious and delicious food. I was at Ciabatta's this week, and I saw all these desserts laid out on the table, and I'm reading, and I'm seeing one word on the desserts, and that word was blessed. When I saw that, I said, man, this is a believer who's putting their culinary gift to bake cakes and desserts that I love and selling and prospering. Come on, church. Some of you are called to be scientists. God wants you to be useful, not just in the church with spiritual gifts, but out there in the community. And spread the gospel wherever you go as you use your talents and gifts. So it's time for you to unwrap your cloth. Don't let fear and your misinterpretation of what God really is. He's not harsh. He's not hard. He is kind and good and generous. Don't oppose what he has called you to become. If you're called to be a housewife, then be the best mom and train up your children the best way that you can. If that's what you love to do. And maybe open up a nursery. Start a nursery business if you love kids. If you love dogs and pets, start a grooming service. Oh, I don't have the, I don't know. If, no, hey, listen, baby. Nobody's born knowing to do anything. We learn. Go to school. Go get training. Go learn from somebody else. Start up from the bottom working for somebody. Learn the business and then start your own business. It's time to unwrap your piece of cloth. Tap your neighbor and say, it's time to unwrap your piece of cloth. That's another one. Remember last week I said the richest place on the face of the earth is where? Cemetery. People spend their whole life doing, never doing what they were truly called or desired to do, and they go to the grave along with their potential. Don't let your potential go to the grave with you. Are there resources that he wants to sow, that he wants you to sow into his kingdom? Yes. Are there jobs, positions, careers, higher education that's being shielded because of your piece of cloth? If your dream is to go to college, then make plans for going to college. Let 2021 be the year where you start at least making the plans, finding out how to do it, how to get the money, how to do get everything down, organized, so you know what you're believing God for. Don't just dream and let those desires go to waste and go to the grave. Get a journal. Write down what it will take for you to go and get a 4-year degree or an 8-year degree. Do it if that is your dream, the dream that God put in you. There are patients out there waiting for you. Oh, that's Matthew agreeing with me. Okay. God wants you to let go and unfold your piece of cloth and follow him into something new that would be of greater benefit to his kingdom and a blessing to you in return. Today, the woman that blesses us with cleaning is blessing me. She's blessing the community. She's blessing all of her employees are Christians. She's blessing churches. She's blessing families. All because she chose to use her administrative gifts that God gave her. Her mina that God gave her. And her husband is an amazing cook. I'm already praying for that. Lord, provide. Touch his heart. I wouldn't mind him bringing some food for me once in a while. He's a cook. If you're a good cook, where's your restaurant? Where's your bistro? Where's your recipes? Where's the book that you're going to write with your recipes? Where is it? Is it still in here? It's not supposed to be only here. It's supposed to be out there. As long as it's only in here, it's covered. Got to get it from here to out here. That's uncovering it. Get the cloth out. If you're called to be a school teacher, why aren't you teaching? If you're called to be a teacher in the church, why aren't you teaching? If you're called to be a principal, why aren't you leading a high school, an elementary school? Uncover that cloth. Because remember, Jesus, he came back to see how much those meanness produced. And we know he's coming back. We know it's going to be sometime in the future. He said the end is not yet. So right now we have opportunity to be busy. Remember, the plane is not leaving till Sunday. Do not go to the airport on Monday because chances are the flight can even get canceled, right? You got a whole week to be busy, productive. As far as Jesus is returning, you got maybe another 50, 60, maybe 100, maybe a lifetime. I don't think he's going to come back in my lifetime, honestly. Because when he comes back, he's not going to come back to rescue us. He's going to come back when the church has finished his job. Bible says that creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. So when we become mature and we start doing the works of Jesus and we evangelize the whole world, then we'll be ready to go, not ready to be rescued. Big difference in both statements. We're just going to go because we finished our job and not go because we've just crashed and burned and we need to be rescued. Hallelujah! Do you receive this morning? Woo! Glory to God. And there you have it. So, it's not time. But what time is it right now? Get busy. With what? Your talent. Your talent. What can paralyze you is one thing. It's exactly what paralyzed that third man. I was afraid. And when we pray today before the service began, we always do praying. We give charge to the angels to go out and minister and fight for you and bring what God the Father, our Father, has for you this day. And when we were praying, somebody asked me, what is God speaking right now? What should we pray for? I said, one thing. I feel God wants to free people from fear. Remember last week, I saw angels coming down the hallways, the aisles. You don't remember. And they were cutting chains. Those chains, now I see clearer, more clearly than ever. Those chains is the fears that bind you, holds you back from moving forward. That's what chains do. They keep you in one position and you can't move forward. Cutting them. You know what God is doing? He's activating his church. And he's doing it by freeing us this morning, first of all, from paralyzing fear. First thing that you would need to do right now is repent of your excuses, even if they're good ones. But God is not convinced. Repent of your excuses. If you're called to write songs and record music, whatever it is that you're called to do, your Mina is gonna come out of that cloth right now. And we're gonna pray that God will melt away, destroy all of your excuses, all the words that you have spoken over your own soul. All the thoughts that you have allowed in your mind that goes against your own soul and the Mina that God put in your life. Somebody's called to be a soccer player. Yeah, there you go. There's a soccer player right there. That's a future Ronaldinho. A blonde Ronaldinho. There you go. Beckham. David Beckham right there. In the works. I forgot what I was saying. The ball distracted me. But that's okay. I love it when kids do that. This is the place where they need to do these things. It's a good distraction. And I'm glad we do have kids. You know, they prayed for a boy for so long. And God gave it to them after years of believing God. So we celebrate it. I want that boy running around, kicking the ball around, because there was a time when we didn't have anybody like that. Now we do, so let's celebrate it. Amen. Let's celebrate it. Just don't let it be too many kids. One is good. And they all grow up. Yeah. So we're going to destroy that fear. And we're going to pull down that stronghold of excuses in your mind, in your heart. And you're going to see after we do this, how in your spirit, in your heart, and in your spirit, you're going to start having those desires actually become so strong that you're going to say, why not go after it? Why not believe God? Why not just take the step? The desire will be stronger than whatever was holding you back. Are you ready for something new in your life? These messages are not random. They're designed by God for you. Because 2021 is the beginning. Believe me, church, this year is going to be phenomenal. 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 And He's got you in mind. He's got you in His heart. You're part of it. No matter what your background is, if you speak English, don't speak English, so what? Maybe God will give you a business only with Brazilians, only with Spanish. This mall is full of them. You walk into those places, you see signs that says, aquí se habla español, no inglés. You go to Hialeah, if you don't speak Spanish, you don't eat. That's fine, that's their community and they're prospering. That shows you how people, they don't see limitations. If that's the community, then that's where I'm going to go and that's where I'm going to prosper. That's a wonderful thing. That's how it should be. God already has the exact location for you, the exact place, the exact school, the exact location for your next restaurant, for your next business, the timing. Everything is already prepared because the one who gives the mina also gives the resources to go along with the mina. It's His mina. Woo! Glory to God. Amen. All He wants you to do is get rid of that fear, that paralyzing fear, along with your excuses. You're ready for it? Stand to your feet if you are. If you're a husband and wife sitting together, join hands. Because I've noticed throughout the years that when one is fearful, it contaminates the other. And vice versa. So both need to pray this prayer. God's going to do amazing things in you. Close your eyes and say with me, Lord, forgive me for all the lame excuses that I have convinced myself with. I don't want those excuses anymore. I cancel those words. I command those words in my soul to come out now. And its effects come out of my soul now. I choose never to believe in those excuses again. And I renounce fear. I rebuke fear, the spirit of fear. For Jesus did not give me a spirit of fear. He gave me the Holy Spirit. He gave me faith. So I embrace faith, and I reject fear in my life. I decree that it no longer will paralyze me. Jesus, lead me on to areas, to do things, to places that I only dreamed of. Take me, Lord. I'm ready for the first step. Bring the people, the resources, everything that I need to accomplish what you've called me to do and to be. I ask you this, Lord. And from this day on, I will believe you. I will trust you. And I will move forward with your calling on my life. In the name of Jesus, and everybody say amen. Glory to God. One more prayer, quick one. If you're not sure that you're saved this morning, that Jesus is the Lord of your life, you that are watching by television as well, this morning you can receive him as your Lord and Savior. Have your sins forgiven. Be a part of what God is doing and inherit eternal life. Jesus died for your sins. Pray this prayer with me if you want to invite Jesus into your life. Say this, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins and be my Lord. I believe that you died for me. And I invite you in my life for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 We can never end until we pray that prayer. Because sometimes even somebody watching could be needing to pray that prayer. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this word here today, for what you've spoken to us and what you are speaking. Father, my Father, our Father, we're so grateful that we have a Father. We're so grateful that you're leading us, Lord, to places, to do things that you have imagined for us, you have prepared for us. And we thank you, Lord, that you're awakening us towards that. And we thank you, my Father, that you're freeing us, your children, from all the fear that was bringing us and keeping us in bondage. And you're showing us how much you care about, how much you love us, and how much you've already invested in us for the glory of the kingdom and our benefit. So lead us on, Father. As we leave here today, Father, let this day, even today, the opportunities start coming. Let this day, even today, be the day where we go and we start speaking and writing down and invest in the excitement that began here this morning over us. So, hallelujah. Somebody's called to start a car dealership. I just saw it. I saw in the spirit a car dealership. There's somebody here that has that desire. Yeah, and God is saying, go start it. Go get ready. Because that is what you have been called to do. To sell cars, to have a car dealership. I saw a car dealership. Maybe it's here. I don't know. If it's here, just say, I receive it, Lord. If it's on television, then receive it. But I saw clearly a car dealership. I didn't see you working for a car dealership. I saw you starting a car dealership. Now, there's nothing wrong with working for a car dealership, but that's not what I saw. I saw you starting a car dealership. So praise God for that. Amen. Praise God. You're going to sell me my next car, maybe. I don't know. So thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Because this is your flow. This is your anointing. This is what you're saying to us. You're positioning us for great things, positioning us for great effectiveness. You're activating the church. Glory be to God. And we thank you that fear will no longer accompany us. Fear will no longer paralyze us. Lord, we decree and declare we are not that third servant. We are the first servant, and we are the second servant who took the minas and invested it. We are those who believe. So we thank you that it will begin even now. I speak this over our ministry, over our people, even now. I speak this over this ministry. Even now, we will move forward like never before in the calling for the nations. And to train and to equip the people for the calling that they have for their lives. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We thank you that that is our Mina. And we thank you for the glory of the Lord are going to produce many more Minas. So I declare, Father, that all of us here are going to produce many more Minas. Many more from what was originally given to us. In the name of Jesus, and all the church say amen. Amen. Woo. God bless you. Next week, message is called Get in the Boxing Arena. We'll see you next Sunday. God bless you. Be blessed.